Welcome to this presentation on the current crisis facing libraries and responses we can either take immediately or prepare to face this ongoing threat. For the sake of brevity, I will not be reading out all of the slides or pausing on them, as most of them are simply providing supporting evidence and citations. Feel free to pause this presentation at any time or download the slide deck if you wish to examine a particular slide in more detail. Items with the citations that are not marked as quotes are my summaries of the sources, including my personal notes of live events. Any errors in them are my own. Likewise, my opinions and conclusions are my own and not the responsibility of my employer or anyone else. The key points of this presentation are as follows. 1. We are under attack. 2. We have a duty to act. 3. There are actions we can take. And 4. Procedures and training need to be updated. While some of the details I will draw upon will be related to the situation at my employer, the general lessons they embody are universal. Part 1. The War on Libraries. Libraries are under attack. There is a culture war on, and librarians are, as always, on the front lines. Attacks on libraries have reached historic scope and proportions. Unfortunately, we're losing due to insufficient organized defenses and counteroffensives. This is in contrast to our attackers, who are organized, trained, and networked at every level. This war has extended beyond the usual targets of physical media and collections to new demands regarding online databases and other electronic resources. Methods have included attempts at outright government censorship, as well as intimidation and threats, including death threats, including here in the Chicago suburbs. This war is no parochial matter. It has resulted in not only a slew of national media reports, but also a hearing in Congress. Horrific anecdotes are far too easy to find if you want them. Instead, I'm going to talk about the sheer scale of the crisis in statistical terms now. In 2020, the ALA Office for Intellectual Freedom tracked 156 challenges. In 2021, they handled an unprecedented 729 challenges, a more than fourfold increase. And yet even this hides the true scope of the problem, because those challenges were not distributed evenly throughout the year. The bulk of the challenges came once the school year started in the fall. In just 3 months, one quarter of the year, the OIF handled over 45% of that year's challenges. They had gone from one challenge every 2 to 3 days in 2020 to 3 to 4 challenges per day in the fall of 2021, the highest rate that anyone can remember. The Robert B. Downs Intellectual Freedom Award Committee handed out 2 awards for the first time in nearly 20 years, awarding the second to the OIF staff for their aid and perseverance under an unprecedented workload, while down to just 2 staff members, even before the full scope of the increase in challenges had been calculated. This did not let up in 2022. With 2 months still to go in the year, the number of challenges reported to the ALA had broken last year's record high. At the current rate, the ALA is on track for at least 5 to 6 times as many challenges as just 2 years ago. And on Christmas Eve, The Guardian, a British newspaper of record, published a headline on its website predicting that 2023 may see even higher numbers. These challenges are also seeing unprecedented levels of success. PEN America has, for the first time ever, published its own censorship statistics, as well as a complete database of the incidents they track. PEN America does not have the same kind of censorship reporting system as the ALA, and they restricted their report to just successful instances of school censorship lasting at least 1 day. But the results are staggering. Taking a look at school libraries from July 2021 through March 2022, they found 184 books banned in both libraries and classrooms, another 197 books banned in libraries, and, against best practice guidelines from the ALA and others, a further 731 books pulled from circulation while a challenge against them was pending. These numbers do not include titles banned from classroom libraries but not a school's official library system, which their methodology makes impossible to disaggregate from curriculum bans. And again, these are just publicly known cases of successful censorship. Lest you think it can't happen here, 3 separate cases were in the Chicago North suburbs, 2 resulting in permanent censorship of school libraries at a school covered by one of our consortium's libraries. Of course, this is merely a fraction of the full picture, as the overwhelming majority of challenges go unreported. For example, neither set of statistics I've cited lists New Kid as one of the most challenged titles, despite the fact that both it and its author have been the subject of multiple high-profile attacks and successful, outright censorship. A panel at ALA Annual specifically noted this was due to challenges not being reported. Part 2. Professional responsibilities. As librarians, both as members of the profession and its community, and as employees of an institution that has endorsed various rights statements in its policies, we have a duty to act in the face of this threat. Our profession's explicit ethical obligations extend to entire communities and social systems beyond the confines of our property lines or our district, and even encompass proactive steps, not mere resistance when an attack occurs. Our board, like so many others, has endorsed a number of foundational intellectual freedom documents, including the Library Bill of Rights and the Freedom to Read Statement. The Library Bill of Rights, which has stood for more than 80 years, not only calls on us to challenge censorship, but also to cooperate with outside groups with the same goals. The Freedom to Read Statement embodies this call with its joint declaration that we, in alliance with publishers, are the guardians of the people's rights and must contest any attempt at censorship. Part 3. Responses. Having established our duty to act, what is being done about this crisis, and what can be done about this crisis? The ALA has launched a wide variety of projects. By November last year, the crisis has grown to the point that the ALA Executive Board and the boards of every single ALA division put out a joint statement addressing it. Other statements and resolutions have followed. Professional education and discussion, such as a 4-hour-long, 3-panel ALA annual session just to address challenges to graphic novels and comics, are a recurring theme. The Intellectual Freedom Committee is spearheading multiple projects, including a toolkit for dealing with new excuses for censorship, a rewrite of the Intellectual Freedom and Censorship Q&A, and, most significantly, an update to the Freedom to Read Statement, which has remained largely untouched in its nearly 70 years of existence, as it's endorsed by not just our library's policies, but it's incorporated into library policies across the country, and endorsed by a wide variety of organizations beyond the library and publishing worlds. Furthermore, the ALA has gone on the offensive, in unison with dozens of other organizations, across the literary world and beyond. I have personally seen publisher advertising money being spent on this issue and linking to this campaign. But what can we do? We do not have to be passive and wait to be directly attacked before taking action. We can prepare our defenses and even take preemptive action both internally and through external partnerships. On a policy level, our board can join other libraries in updating our collection development policy to eliminate the possibility of serial challenges against the same material. The board can also pass resolutions against book bans, and we can ask our government partners to do the same. Unite Against Book Bans even has a sample resolution to use as a template. On a procedural level, we can make sure that review sources, which our collection development policy gives weight to, are specified in each collection's collection management plan, so that we can more effectively justify our selection of challenged materials on the basis of reviews in those sources. And on communications and service level, we can help members suffering private tax on what they can read by promoting our digital borrowing options. Although we talk about the importance of keeping secret what items members have on hold or checked out so that even a hostile family member can't find out, if a member still has to bring a physical book home with them, that itself makes them vulnerable. Ebooks are much easier to keep concealed. Nor do we have to be the only advocates for our cause. Nationally, we can partner with and promote Unite Against Book Bans, either on our own or as a consortium. A consortium which, I might reiterate, has a member library in the same town as two of the three school book bannings in Chicago's north suburbs. Locally, we should be building and growing grassroots support for us and our values. Local advocacy groups are already being formed elsewhere, but when formed in response to attacks, they are stuck playing catch-up, even with support from national organizations. We cannot simply wait to be attacked. Speaking of grassroots advocacy, when youth and teen materials are under attack, often their greatest defenders are the children and teens who read them. We must find ways to empower their voices as advocates, not just defenders, and in ways that work for them in other spaces where their rights might come under attack. Other actions we can take include reaching out to partners in the schools we serve to ensure that we are prepared to help each other if needed. We can also reach out to our elected officials and make sure they will tell us if they are receiving pressure to take action against us and our members. And we can advocate for our own interests if hostile legislation is on the table. Part 4. Procedures. Taking the steps described in the prior section would form an excellent foundation for defense against an attack. But we must still consider procedures and training for how staff deal with everything from an informal complaint to a formal challenge. Not following an established procedure when removing or restricting access to books is considered legal evidence of the unconstitutionality of that action. Not having an established procedure is not viewed much better. This means that it is important that staff are trained in their part of this procedure. We are fortunate that we have a policy that describes procedures in keeping with best practices for what to do in the event of a formal challenge to materials. Unfortunately, our policy only describes procedures once a formal challenge is received, not what staff should do when approached on the subject or how to determine that the intent to make a formal challenge exists. In fact, we have absolutely no policy or procedures or even talking points addressing how to handle informal complaints. This is despite the fact that we have had 3 complaints so far this year, one of which remained informal, one of which wished to express a complaint beyond the informal conversation they had had with department staff, but was not given the best avenue for doing so, and one of which explicitly said that the books should not be in the youth collections. Fortunately, there are multiple sources of best practices that we can borrow from to develop procedures that we can then train staff on. The Intellectual Freedom Manual, the ALA's Selection and Reconsideration Policy Toolkit, and the Graphic Novels and Comics Roundtable Conference Sessions and Be Prepared Toolkit, among other resources, have both advice and sample policies and procedures. The Intellectual Freedom Manual has an entire section laying out a 9-step procedure for handling informal complaints, with steps 6 and 7, should they be necessary, being to explain the formal reconsideration process and, assuming the conversation does not end there, to provide a copy of the relevant policy and form, and further explanation about both the necessity of a fully completed form and that it will become part of the public record. The ALA's Online Selection and Reconsideration Policy Toolkit provides a more abbreviated example procedure. After a discussion of informal complaints, the fact that they may turn into formal challenges, and an acknowledgement that formal challenges are a right also acknowledged by our own collection development policy. These sources generally exhibit an escalation framework in which a member goes from an informal complaint at a service desk to filing a reconsideration request form. This includes informal conversations in which library staff explain the library's role and values and offer an off-ramp. Formal conversations which the member can feel more completely heard while a senior staff member can be more prepared to defend the library, and potentially discouraging explanations of the formal reconsideration form and process, which nevertheless might not prevent a formal reconsideration request. Again, our current situation is that we have no procedures, talking points, or training for dealing with any stage of this escalation before a formal request is filed. Detailed procedures should be drawn up based on the aforementioned resources, a comprehensive list of talking points created using both those resources and the core ethics documents endorsed in our policies, and mandatory training for relevant staff developed and deployed. Last but not least, we can report challenges. This advice can be found coming from the ALA's Fight Censorship page, the OIF's Intellectual Freedom blog, the State of America's Libraries report, the OIF's acceptance speech at the Robert B. Downs Intellectual Freedom Award reception, the Association for Library Service to Children's Intellectual Freedom Committee, the Massive United Against Book Bans Alliance, the Graphic Novels and Comics Roundtable, both online and at ALA Annual, and personal conversations with OIF staff, as well as innumerable ALA Council resolutions, social media posts, and other calls to action. Why? Because a complete understanding of attacks on libraries is necessary not just for PR, but to completely prepare and deploy both reactive and proactive defenses against those attacks. This is particularly key when faced with coordinated attacks, as we are now. Given the small percentage of cases that is reported, every scrap of data is invaluable to being able to identify trends and prepare the appropriate training and support. Nothing that I have discussed regarding the attacks directed against us and the actions being taken to counter them would be possible without having data about those attacks. And, of course, it is our professional responsibility to confront these attacks and aid others with our knowledge, including our knowledge of attacks we experience. Given all of this, when should we report a challenge? Our procedures should include reporting challenges regardless of whether or not they reach the formal reconsideration stage of the escalation framework. The Office for Intellectual Freedom has emphasized both in its guidance on whether to report censorship and in a private email to me regarding this specific point that the dividing line between a complaint and a challenge is the desire or intent of the request, not its formality level. Or, to put it another way, whether the member is actually making a request or just complaining. Censorship attempts also include any attempt to pressure the library into taking action, even when expressed on social media or calling on others to campaign against our materials. Actions that are likely attempts to physically restrict the public's access to library materials should also be reported to censorship. This is something which has occurred to us already. Updates after any escalation or resolution should also be reported. In order to achieve all of this, we must promote reporting challenges and censorship. The obvious starting point is training for staff. However, reports can be filed by anyone, not just library staff. Therefore, we should also promote the report censorship message to the public. Remember, when in doubt, report. OIF staff are the best equipped to determine what does and does not meet their criteria for reporting. Given that the overwhelming majority of incidents nationally are not reported, it is better to err on the side of filing and let them decide whether to count it or not. This is true even if you think someone else might have already reported the incident, because the OIF will take care of any duplicate reports. That concludes this presentation. A summary of recommended action items is on screen now. Thank you for your time.